Good morning and welcome to worship at St. Andrew's. It is a delight to be here this morning and to welcome you to worshiping with us. It is a joy and a privilege for me to lead this worship service here in St. Andrew's Church. We are on the way to Jerusalem to celebrate the mystery of Easter. We remember that Jesus took the road to Jerusalem. It was a difficult road, for the way of the cross is not easy. We praise and worship you, O God. Fill us and renew us with your Spirit. Our hymn of praise comes from the Blue Book of Praise, and it's number 235, Alas, and Did My Saviour Bleed?
Save. A reading for the fourth Sunday in Lent. God provides for every need.
Guidance in right paths, presence in darkest valleys, nourishment beyond measure.
God shines light on the world in Jesus.
Opening eyes that are blind, exposing prejudice and fear, offering new understanding of life's good purpose.
But we persist in our ways.
Judging by appearance, denying others' experience, hoarding what we can for ourselves.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Let us all pray together.
Creator God, you are the source of light and love, rest and nurture, hope and peace. Open our eyes to your goodness. Empower us to live as children of light, bringing a rich harvest of all that is good and right and true. Enlighten us to see the world with your eyes of love, so may all people know your goodness and mercy forever. Through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen.
Set us free by the truth you now bring. been through fire, we've been through rain, we've been refined by the power of His name. We've fallen deeper in love with You. You've burned this truth in our land. With songs again of our God who reigns on high. By His grace again we'll fly. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven.
We welcome children and youth to this fourth Sunday in Lent as we make our journey with Jesus to Jerusalem and to the cross. Let us pray together. Dear God, be with us in our extended March break. Keep us safe and keep us healthy. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the whole wide world in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands.
He's got my brothers and my sisters in His hands. He's got my brothers and my sisters in His hands. He's got my brothers and my sisters in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands.
He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the whole wide world in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands.
He's got the little bitty baby
in His hands.
He's got the little bitty baby
in His hands.
He's got the little bitty baby
in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands.
He's got the birds in the air in His hands. He's got the whales in the sea in His hands. He's got you and He's got me in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got
everybody here in His hands. He's got everybody here in His hands. He's got everybody here in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the
Lord, we come before you on this fourth Sunday in Lent with our prayers. Let us pray. God of the covenant, through your promise to Abraham and Sarah, you have blessed countless generations. Turn us once again to your abundant life made ours through Jesus Christ. Help us in this season of Lent to take time for reflection, prayer, and meditation. Teach us to live according to your wise and loving ways. Assist us in our journey to Good Friday and Easter to turn towards you, to take up our cross and leave behind all that keeps us from following Jesus. May we be a sign of your presence to those around us. In Jesus' name. Lord, hear us as we come to you this morning on this fourth Sunday in Lent, confessing our failures and our sins. Patient God, you call, but we do not listen. You direct, but we go our own way. You challenge, but we turn away. Humble God, we crave power, and you come in weakness. We look to authority, and you give love. We seek safety, and you lead us to the cross. Compassionate God, forgive us. Hear us now as we offer our silent prayers of confession. Lord, help us to keep our eyes focused on Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. For his sake we pray. Amen. Here is good news, the good news of the gospel. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have life everlasting. Amen. May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you. Let us pray. Loving God, attend to us as we open your word. May our hearts and spirits listen for your will for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm reading from the New International Version of the Holy Bible, from the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 to 9, and found on page 11 of the New International Version. The Call of Abram. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions that had accumulated and the people they had acquired in Haran. And they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he went on towards the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Then Abram set out and continued toward the Negev. Our second reading is from the Gospel according to St. Mark. And we're looking at chapter 10, verses 32 to 34, found on page 980 of the New International Version. Jesus again predicts his death. They were on their way up to Jerusalem, with Jesus leading the way, and the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. Again, he took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. "We are going up to Jerusalem," he said, "and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise." This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord God, help us to know your presence with us. Help us to search our hearts and to know that you are present with us. Help us as we make our journey with Jesus. In Jesus' name and for his sake, we pray. Amen. In these weeks leading up to Easter, we are all on a journey. We're on a journey with Jesus to Jerusalem and to the cross. Our journey with Jesus involves reflection, meditation, prayer, and recommitment. Our Old Testament reading this morning is about a journey. In Genesis chapter 12, we hear about God's call to Abraham to go on a journey, a long journey. The 12th chapter of Genesis perhaps represents the beginning of the whole journey of God's people. This section that we read today, this section that we read, features three different parts to it. First, we have God's direction to, or instruction to, Abraham. Then we have God's promise to Abraham. And then we have Abraham's obedience to God. God speaks to Abraham, it would seem, out of the blue, without any prior indication of any direction to Abraham. God speaks to Abraham, and God calls to Abraham to go on a journey, to go on a pilgrimage, to go to a place that he has never been before, to go to an unknown land and be in unknown territory in order that he might know to trust in God's guidance and God's provision for him. The 12th chapter of Genesis, at the very beginning of that 12th chapter of Genesis, Abraham makes an unquestioning act of faith. Abraham, God calls to Abraham, and Abraham responds to God's call when God calls to him. When God says to Abraham, go, Abraham is prepared to go. At this point in time, Abraham and his wife Sarah are living contentedly in Haran, in northern Mesopotamia, what we today call Turkey. Abraham and Sarah were getting on in years, but God calls to Abraham, leave your country and your people and your household and go to a place that I will give to you, and I will make of you a great nation. God is telling Abraham to migrate, to set out from where he is, living in Haran, to set out on a journey and to give up his current lifestyle and to become a nomad. Abraham must leave the familiar place, and he must leave the familiar people in order to embark on a journey into the unknown. When God spoke to Moses out of the burning bush, when Moses took his flock of sheep to Mount Horeb, and God spoke to Moses out of the burning bush, you will remember that Moses offered one excuse after another to God about why he was not able to do what God was calling him to do. Moses said, I am not able to speak. No one will listen to me. But unlike Moses, we find that Abraham, when God speaks to him, Abraham simply does as God directs him to do. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews puts it this way: by faith Abraham obeyed and went, not knowing where he was going to. Abraham was prepared to give up the certainty of the life that he had at the present, and he was prepared to venture out and to go into places where things were not certain, where he was traveling to places that were unfamiliar to him, and where he would come to a time where there would be a culture shock, and he would find himself in a strange land among strangers. I know that some of you have come to Canada from another country, and I'm sure that you would have had certain feelings about leaving your homeland, about all the challenges that you might face as you came to a new country with different laws and different traditions. Abraham was like that too. Anyone who has immigrated would be able to understand some of the feelings that Abraham experienced as he set out on that journey, not knowing where he was to go. Abraham is at a major intersection. God spoke to Abraham and called him to set out on a journey. Abraham could choose to ignore God's instruction, or Abraham could choose to accept God's instruction. So how did Abraham respond? Did he respond cautiously? Did he respond in wonder? Did he respond in haste? Did he respond grudgingly? All that we're told in this account is that Abraham went as the Lord told him to go. Abraham chose to follow God's leading. Abraham did so with unquestioning faith because he believed in God's promises. He believed that God would make him the father of many nations and that he would prove to be a blessing to all. Today, God calls us, just as he called Abraham, he calls us to listen to his direction and to be willing to venture. During the Second World War, Gertrude Montgomery served with the Red Cross. She was stationed in Manila in the Philippines at the time that that city was liberated. And she tells with wonder what she observed there at that time. The people, she says, dug up the instruments that were buried. And with makeshift lighting, amidst all the destruction, the civic orchestra put on a concert. They played Dvorak's New World Symphony. They did not linger in the past, but they embarked on a new beginning with excitement in their music and hope in their hearts. God spoke to Abraham. God said to Abraham, go. And Abraham went. Abraham must have had many wistful moments along the way. He must have wondered about this long and challenging and at times worrying journey. He encountered many dangers and difficulties along the way. Drought, sandstorms, bands of robbers, sickness, and fatigue. But Abraham continued on, true to the start that he had made. Abraham continued in spite of uncertainty. Abraham did not need to know the end from the beginning. He was confident that God was with him. The philosopher Lao Tzu once said, "A journey of 1,000 miles must begin with a single step." Abraham heard God speak to him, "Leave your country, your people, your father's household, and go to the land that I will give you, and I will make of you a great nation." Abraham responded to that call. The letter to the Hebrews says this: "Abraham looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and whose maker is God." Spiritually, Abraham had found a city, a dwelling place for new hope, new and new ideals. Abraham responded to God in trust and obedience, and he set out on a journey into the unknown. During these challenging and uncertain times of COVID-19, Abraham is an example to us. We, like Abraham, need to trust in God's goodness and in God's providential care. Let us pray. Gracious God, in Abraham we see trust on obedience. Too often we are reluctant to hear your voice calling us to new tasks and in new directions. Help us to look to you and trust in your promises. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Abraham was the son of Terah, who lived in a distant land. He had a wife by the name of Sarah. They were really old. God made a promise to Abraham that he would have a son, and from that son would come a nation as many as the stars. Whoa. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Many years went by for them, but still they trusted God. They knew He would fulfill His promise if they just believed. Whoa. Oh, in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Yes, He will direct your path. Abraham and Sarah had a baby boy. God fulfilled His promise just like He said He would.
Lord, we come to You on this fourth Sunday of Lent with our prayers of thanksgiving and our prayers for others. Let us pray. Loving God, maker of all things, we praise You for all of Your gifts. We thank You for springtime, for the warmth of the sunshine and the lengthening of the days. We thank You for the blessings of health and strength. We give You thanks for the care and concern that we experience day by day. We're grateful for all those who are an example to us, those whose opinion we respect and to whom we know we can go for guidance and advice. We pray for our government leaders, for all medical officers of health, and those who work in public health, that You would give them the wisdom they need to guide us through these challenging and uncertain times. We remember teachers and students as they continue their March break. Keep them safe and keep them well. God of mercy and compassion, we pray for all those who are ill, those who suffer from coronavirus. Give them courage and touch them with Your healing presence. Let Your power to restore and renew be strong within them. Be present to all those who are currently in quarantine. Help them to use this time apart in positive ways. We pray for those who have lost a loved one. As Jesus spoke words of encouragement to His disciples, so we ask that Your comfort might come to those who mourn. We remember in prayer those whose lives are dedicated to the healing and care of the sick, those in public health, physicians and nurses. We ask Your blessing on their work in our clinics, our hospitals, and in long-term care. O God, we make our journey through Lent to Easter. Be with us in the time when we cannot be, in the interest of public health, meet together as a community. Keep us strong in our faith and help us to trust in Your goodness and care in these challenging and uncertain times. All-knowing God, take our thoughts and our prayers and use them to further your purposes. Through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We come before you this morning presenting our tithes and our offerings. Freely we have received, freely let us give. Our concluding hymn this morning comes from the Blue Book of Praise. It's number 352 in the Blue Book of Praise, and Can It Be That I Should Gain?
Thank you.
grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and always. Amen.